next guest is Dr. Mark Gordon. He has been a strong advocate of integrative functional medicine in the promotion of wellness medicine throughout the correction of underlying hormonal deficiencies. He was instrumental in promoting the recognition of traumatic brain injury as a cause of hormonal deficiency in the hallmark presentation of ESPN's Outside the Lines. His book, The Clinical Application of Interventional Medicine, is recognized by his peers as a primer for the standards of care and assessment for interventional endocrinology, anti-aging medicine. Dr. Mark Gordon, please get on stage.
Siempre eres la más guapa. Definitely not the 405 freeway. recognition of faces, naming the person behind the face, or remembering those romantic evenings, or even your time here at breakfast. Then ask yourself, how many of the names and people that you've met since you've been here will you remember a week from now? Or 2 weeks? This is an illustration of the process of neurotransmission from one neuron to another. And what happens is electrical impulse is propagated down the nerve to the subsequent one. And this is how memories are formed and recalled and then relived. It travels along the axon. When it arrives at the synapse, it releases a chemical called a neurotransmitter, which goes to the opposite side of the receiving end and makes that electrical chemical connection to continue that thought. So when you're thinking of something and then all of a sudden it's like, what was I just thinking? It's because the continuation of that transmission to the recognition part of the brain has been affected. So once the neurotransmitter connects to a receptor on the opposite side, it stimulates the process to continue the propagation of the thought process. But what happens is when there's any kind of inflammation, free radical damage, oxidative stress, it interrupts that area or the ability of one nerve to communicate with the next. And it denigrates. And that denigration of quality is an effect on our cognition. So how truly important is this process of neuroinflammation or inflammation and oxidative stress on our well-being? Well, in this article, they finally decided that Parkinson's disease, amongst others, is now being accepted as a condition arising from the effects of inflammation and oxidative stress. Specifically, the damaging effect of the inflammation on the energy production of ATP, which comes from mitochondria. So they're finding that this inflammation inhibits, alters, stops chemical processes that help our body to generate ATP to run everything. This is a mitochondria. It's responsible for the production of the body's energy molecule called ATP. An interruption of the ATP production leads to failure of support systems. The iron-gated channel, which allows for sodium potassium chloride to regulate this electrical impulse down the nerve. And the interruption of ATP can be traced back to mitochondrial dysfunction caused by a number of free radicals that are produced in the normal aging process, also what certain things will do, like bad tequila, great vodka, good single malt scotch. These things can increase the free radicals in the brain through glucose relating. And it increases the free radicals, which stresses the chemistry of the brain, putting us at risk for developing those things that are written on the right side. The past 3 to 5 years, an incredible amount of inflammation. Inflammation has been coming up. Talking about the relevancy of oxidative stress and inflammation on precipitating all these diseases. In Alzheimer's disease, oxidative stress induced inflammation is being looked at as the hallmark pathological finding called neurofibril tangles. As you can see from this slide in parentheses, that's the number of articles that have been written on each one of those diseases in the past 15 years. That's a lot of articles that have come out specifically saying the relationship between inflammation and those diseases. And the fact that inflammation may be at the root cause for these conditions may account for why the medication that we presently use to treat these diseases do very little to stop the progression of the illness. They're not addressing the root cause of inflammation. And then this 2009 NFL study that was done, and what they noted was the association between CTE, chronic traumatic encephalitis, form of brain trauma, they put a tie on it so it makes us think it's something totally different than what it really is. I had 6 CTEs, one while swimming, one bicycle, one by hit by a car, and so forth. These are all different modes for developing the same thing. But what they found in football players on the field, that they had at least one traumatic brain injury, that they were 19 times greater risk of developing Alzheimer's disease than at 30 to 49 years of age than the general population. Wow. Well, Although an inflammatory process may start in a remote area of the brain, because the brain is suspended in the fluids from the spinal fluid, the chemistry disseminates throughout the entire brain. So it's not just this part that's being influenced on a biochemical basis, but it's the entire brain. And this is the frontal lobe, and the frontal lobe is the area that's most frequently impaired by in Alzheimer's disease because of the inflammation, diminishing things like pregnenolone, progesterone, alpha-pregnenolone, which we'll talk about shortly. And so that accounts for why there's things like mood change, executive functionings are lost, flexibility in thinking are gone. And then if it involves the temporal lobe, you have increased aggressive behavior, loss of libido, one of the most important ones there, and loss of difficulty in verbally identifying objects in your environment that you might see all the time, an apple, a pear, or whatever. And then in the parietal lobe, difficulty with doing math, with writing words and naming objects and drawing objects, and you know, in the Alzheimer's test, you have to draw the clock. And then in the occipital lobe, visual hallucinations, inability to look at an object and say, oh, that's a hand, or oh, that's someone else's hand. So, no matter how beautiful and detailed a brain scan can be, it cannot show you the information of the free radicals that induce the interruption of the biochemistry that is in the brain and that influences our cognitive abilities. But what we do see in a relatively short time people have had traumatic brain injury is a reduction in the hormones that regulate not only our peripheral functioning, but our brain functioning, as we'll see momentarily. And the ones in the brain are called neurosteroids, and the ones on the peripheral are called neuroactive steroids. And in this study, 56% of the people had, within 3 months, one or multiple hormone deficiencies, and then by 56, by a year, 36% of the people had continuation of hormone deficiencies. So what we are finding out about the impact of these hormone deficiencies relative to neuroplasticity and psychological well-being, it appears that deficiency of any one of these neurosteroids or neuroactive steroids or insufficiency, which means low normal level. You know, this is one of the things that really gets me ticked off is, you know, you see a hormone that has a level or a chemical that has a level between 10 and 90, and your results come in at 11, and you're told off. You're normal, right. Who cares that you have, you know, all the symptomatology I see frequently with thyroid, where you have all the symptomatology, the coarse brittle hair, the drying of the skin, constipation, memory, you know, depression, there are 310,000 articles since 2000 talking about depression and thyroid deficiency. And they say, oh, yeah, you're at, 1.5 instead of 1, which is the marker for being deficient. And you're not depressed, I mean, you're not thyroid deficient, you're depressed, therefore take these antidepressants, right? So anyway, these hormones have neuroprotective benefits on the brain. And diseases that appear to create neuroinflammation causes inflammation that is unopposed if you lose these hormones. It's a catch-22. With the inflammation, you lose the hormones. And then in this study, which followed individuals with head trauma for about 30 years, found that there were increased occurrence of psychiatric vulnerability to diseases, making the patient more susceptible to depression, delusional disorders, and personality disorders. And according to the authors, and I'm going to quote them, they said that the high rate of psychiatric disorders found in the study emphasized the importance of psychiatric follow-up after traumatic brain injury. Well, I'd like to respectfully amend the authors by saying, if you do a hormonal evaluation first, the chances are you won't need the psychiatrist or their magic potions. You'll be able to improve the condition with treatment that addresses the root causes based upon inflammation and oxidative stress. So moving on. Pregnenolone is called the mother of all hormones, being synthesized directly from cholesterol. Therefore, any medication that influences cholesterol production can put your brain at risk for accelerated senility, as these three articles posted are showing. And there's another 24,000 And that's an enhancer of neuroplasticity. So, since time is getting tight, androgens, Rebecca. Androgens are male hormones, the DHEA, the testosterone. These have more than just sexual reproductive benefits to them. They're anti-inflammatory. So they need to be looked at. Estradiol, extremely important for rewiring neurons and nerves when you've had things like a stroke or a traumatic brain injury. And my favorite hormone is growth hormone, which has been, after 20 to 30 years of age, is more important for helping with inflammatory systems in the brain, with protein synthesis and cellular repair. And in this study, 61% of the people who had depression also had growth hormone deficiency. And in 1 to 2 months on supplementation with growth hormone, it was gone. So, benefit of DHEA in 1952 was found to be an incredible antidepressant medication. But it's gone. I mean, no one knows about that. Not until about 93 when they started talking about the benefits of DHEA, over-the-counter product, as monotherapy for depression. So, what we need to do is know how to protect ourselves. And how to protect ourselves is to understand that we can generate these free radicals with activities of daily living. And what we need to do to protect ourselves is to go and have laboratory testing that looks at neurosteroids, neuroactive steroids, and possibly looks at the biomarkers, the three key biomarkers for neurodegeneration, the interleukin-6, tumor necrosis factor, and the interleukin-1-beta, which on LEM, on life extension laboratory, they have these, and they're inexpensive, and they should be done. And then also start on nutraceuticals that are natural, like NAC, N-acetylcysteine, vitamin E, gamma-tocopherols, and ALA, and it helps. And since 2004, we've treated 1,400 citizens, civilians, with multiple traumatic brains on multiple medications. And last year, you heard about my partner, Green Beret, hero, Andrew Moore, who's here someplace, and we've funded 200 veterans and now active military and treating them, and they're getting better off their medication, living a life, going back to school, and doing. Sorry. Thank you.
That's why we want to extend life. So.